So I opened the bowling for my Division 3 cricket club and I have scored a couple of 50s batting at number 8, but my teammates won't acknowledge me as an all-rounder. They still call me a tail-ender. Speaking of all-rounders though, how important have they become in the modern games? Take a look at guys like Ben Stokes, Jason Holder. You know, they can win you matches from the jaws of defeat, either by batting beautifully with the lower order or by bowling those amazing, you know, death overs with their variations and their skills. One such all-rounder that played for Sri Lanka and did that a lot of times is none other than Fariz Maaruf, who's standing right next to me here at NCC, which is, by the way, your home ground. Must be feeling like a second home for you.
Obviously, I mean, I spent 13 years of my time playing here and loved every bit of it. So happy to retire and taking the next step now.
Right. So playing for Sri Lanka as an all-rounder, Fariz, you know, how was it from your school days at Wesley from to here? Was it always like a dream to play for your country, or is it something that came up, you realized, okay, I'm good at cricket, so let me give it a shot?
I think when I started, when I was 9 years old, I had the passion to play cricket. Not, right. I mean, beside cricket, I played numerous other sports as well. But cricket, for some reason, when I was around 12, 13, I mean, a lot of people at college saw me, saw something in me that I could achieve a lot of things in cricket. Right. So I started playing for the national team and the under 15 levels. I was a vice captain. So when I reached that level, I mean, there's something inside me told me that I can go for a certain number of steps, like to achieve my goal, which was definitely to play for the national teams. I mean, any cricketer should have that ambition of playing to the national team. That should be the goal. So it started in that passion, and as everything in life, it has everything has timing.
Of course.
So I think I was at the right place at the right time to start with. So eventually ended up in a career which lasted for so many years, and I'm pretty proud about whatever I've achieved for.
Awesome. And you know, if you watch some of my previous videos of this Life Lessons from Cricket series, this is what brings me to the most important question. As a cricketer for Sri Lanka, what is the biggest lesson in life you've learned by playing cricket?
I think there are so many lessons, I mean, especially when
for you personally, a special lesson that may have, you know, changed your life?
Having the, I mean, cricket, obviously you have to be good at your game, which you are renowned for, you know, unless, and if you aren't good, you know, you won't survive for long. So I mean, the biggest life lesson I would say what I've learned from cricket, being into my life, is carrying that tag of ambassador of Sri Lanka.
Amazing.
So when you go abroad, I mean, you have to act, you have to react, you have to keep your standards, and you're a role model.
So be at your best behavior at all times.
I mean, that's a no-brainer. I mean, you shouldn't be having it. But what I'm trying to say is, you need to have your own identity, but you should always have the pride of having that. You're carrying the Sri Lankan name wherever you go abroad. Mm-hmm. I mean, forget about playing in the middle. I mean, that's, you're good at that job. That's why you get that job.
Right.
But off the field is that's where you make your name, you make your fame, you make your everything in life. So, you know, in life, what I've taught me so many things, as I said, I mean, coming from discipline to the manners to punctuality, being nice to people. You know, this all comes in one frame. But how you hold your you know, when character, especially in social life, that's what it matters. You know, this is what taught me. You know, playing for Sri Lanka, you know, next level is to have a name in the community where people might say, right, he's a retired cricketer and he has done well and he's doing a good job. Apart from cricket, once he's retired, so that's sort of a line that I'm following, as some of the big names have been following. So, you know, life has given me so much, especially cricket has given me so much. So it's my time to. You know, being a retired player to serve something back to Sri Lanka cricket whenever and whichever way possible.
Amazing, amazing. Right, so your career as an all-rounder of Sri Lanka, I know there was a bit of in and out of the team for you once in a while. Yeah. Looking back at your, you know, amazing career that you had, do you have any regrets? Do you think there are things you could have done better or things you could have changed if it was in your control?
I think from about, since I made my debut in 2004, after about five and a half years, I was you know, continuously playing, injury-free, you know, the form was really good. You know, I think I toured probably everything. You know, played in all the matches, especially one day cricket. But, I mean, I wouldn't say regret, but, you know, injuries, I mean, you never know when an injury comes in. You know, you can't say it will come in this point. I mean, you can't just predict. It just comes. I mean, What happened was when I got injured initially in 2009, there are certain other players came in and cemented their place. So once you go out, for you to come back to make the team, there are two factors. Number one, you've got to go back to domestic cricket, perform. Though you perform, the player who replaces you, he's done well, you know, he's going to have that spot for a while. So that's exactly what happened. So one thing in my life with a, you know, I would say regret, but I have the sad part of my cricket career, I would say, is, you know, once upon a time I was groomed as the next captain of Sri Lanka.
Wow, okay, amazing.
So, you know, I couldn't achieve it because of my injury issues, which I couldn't have that form and continuity being in the team.
Right.
So that's a bit of a sadness that I have. But saying that, I mean, I'm a former cricketer, I should say. Until I retired from first class cricket in 2018, I have given my everything for it be my club, my mercantile team, my provincial team. I mean, I don't have any regrets in that way. I'm a person, once I come off the field, and I should be happy about, even though I score a duck or it doesn't come out without any wickets, I should be happy thinking that, you know, I've given my best, but it doesn't work out. I mean, that satisfaction for me carries a long way.
Right.
So it's not about scoring the 50s, scoring 100s, taking the 3 first, taking the 5. It's not that. I mean, stat matters. But what you as a former cricketer, I'm proud to look at myself, is that, you know, though I haven't have that glittering career, you know, eye-opening career, but still, people will still remember me, especially in the first class circuit, that until I retired, I gave my everything.
Amazing.
And when I walked off David, that's what I miss about, you know, being in the field, being in the dressing room, having that banter, having a laugh after a game. And those are the things, once you're retired, you miss it.
Yeah.
But all in all, you know, the career span for so long, you know, we have some good memories, some bad memories as well. But, you know, life moves on, I guess.
Amazing. Farvez Maarouf, up close and personal. If you're a young cricketer hoping to play for your country someday, take that advice. You know, give it your everything, whether it be a school match, club match, or any level. You know, give it your 100%, give it your 100% commitment. Speaking of the lesson for this series, you know, when I look at an all-rounder like Farvez, that's the one thing I can think about. Even in life, don't just be good at one thing. Farvez is a good batsman, he's a good bowler, and a brilliant fielder. So just like that, if you have life skills, be good at multiple things, not just at one thing. Trust me, success will follow. I am Sam, and this is my perspective.